Now, birth defects are frequent. They occur in about 5% of live births, and while the incidence of specific defects fluctuates with time, the overall rates have been stable or decreasing for many years in all parts of the country. Most of the very few that have been specifically associated with exposure to chemicals have been due to abuse of drugs, including tobacco and alcohol. Perhaps 15% are genetic, originating with the parents. 70 or 80% are of unknown origin. It's clear from laboratory studies that defects arising from direct chemical effect require very high doses, and they are threshold dependent. Miscarriages are even more frequent than birth defects. Between 15 and 20% of known pregnancies fail, and as much as 60% of all conceptions do not survive. And much of the latter loss is apparently due to spontaneous genetic defect resulting in embryos that are not viable. Toxic effects that cause birth defects and miscarriage, decreased fertility, and general toxicity to the fetus are all detectable in the laboratory and are quantitated for the pesticides used in forestry and most of those common in agriculture. The potential for genetic effects or mutation, which I mentioned just a moment ago as a cause of miscarriage, also demands careful attention. Mutation is a change in genetic information that is transmitted either to descendants of the organism itself or to some later generation of cells in an organ. For the change to appear in a later generation, the effect must be in reproductive cells. If the change is in some other organ, it will appear only in cells of that organ that are derived from the cells in which the change occurred. I mentioned a little while ago that the genetic information we're concerned about is carried on the very long molecules of DNA in each cell, which are replicated in cell division to assure that all cells of a kind are alike and function correctly. It's obvious that damage to DNA could result in altered cell function, and it's well known that some chemicals, including some pesticides, are able to cause such injury. Obviously, careful examination of pesticides for genetic effect is necessary for registration. And while it is true that some pesticides can cause mutations, genetic damage occurs constantly in all organisms through errors in DNA synthesis, through background radiation, and natural and synthetic chemical impact. Normal energy metabolism creates reactive products which damage DNA literally thousands of times a day in every cell. Fortunately, almost all of that damage is repaired before cellular effects can appear. DNA is the only molecule of the body that is repaired instead of discarded when it's injured. It's important to detect any potential for increases in common genetic diseases such as sickle cell trait or hemophilia and some diabetes, phenylketonuria, and many others. And in the laboratory, there are a variety of short-term assays to test chemicals for their ability to damage DNA or to cause mutation. And these tests use bacteria and yeast, cell cultures, and insects, as well as intact animals. And that information then can be used in estimating whether the chemical has the potential to cause mutation. But it cannot be used to estimate its potency in higher animals. We'll discuss how this information is used in our third program on risk assessment. Along with their value in identifying mutagens, these tests help in judging whether a chemical can cause cancer because there is a strong correlation between ability to cause mutations and ability to cause cancer. Now let's look again at the issue of natural incidence, this time of cancer. Where do we stand at present with respect to the incidence of cancer in the human population? About a quarter of us can expect to contract cancer in our lifetime, and at present rates, about a fifth of us will die of cancer. As yet, sufficient evidence of a relation between pesticide use and increased cancer incidence has not been found, even in the case of pesticides known to cause cancer in the laboratory. Part of the reason for this is, again, the high normal incidence of cancer and the difficulty of detecting any very small increase. In addition, exposures in the field are much smaller than doses used in the laboratory, which are usually maintained at the highest level the animals can tolerate over a lifetime. In fact, chemically induced cancer takes a large fraction of a lifetime to appear. In the human, this lag period may be as much as 15 to 30 years. It's somewhat surprising, given the number of public statements about the great increase in cancer, that when data on cancer deaths with suitable corrections for the increasing age of our population is examined, most kinds of cancer have not increased in frequency over the past several decades. Some kinds of cancer are steadily decreasing. Lung cancer shows the only steady increase, which we know is caused primarily by smoking. This graph shows the situation for males, who have a far greater incidence of lung cancer than females. But I'm afraid that females are catching up tragically fast. There's also some evidence of an increase in breast cancer. To summarize, all toxic phenomena occur in a severity or frequency that's directly related to the amount of chemical that's taken in. This is true for effects that arise from a single exposure or effects that are caused by a lifetime of low-level contact. It's true for effects that disappear soon after they occur and effects that are irreversible, such as cancer. Through the use of laboratory tests with experimental animals, cell preparations, and other systems, and knowledge of the way these systems relate to humans, it's possible to make predictions of the potential for adverse effects on humans and to regulate the use of pesticides accordingly. Obviously, it's also necessary to know how pesticides affect wildlife, fish, land and water insects, and domestic animals. It's routine to study effects on fish and other aquatic species and land insects in the laboratory and in the field. As one might expect, a few standard species are used to represent the very broad array of species in nature. Testing of various standard bird species is all part of the usual sequence. Some testing of larger mammals is often done, but as in the case of humans, data from laboratory animals is often extrapolated to the larger species. For wild rodents and other small animals, the laboratory animal data can be applied almost directly. And in all of these cases, field studies are used to validate the predictions from laboratory testing. Information on the potential environmental effects of various pesticides is available to the pesticide user. The best immediate sources of data are the pesticide background statements prepared for the Forest Service, as well as environmental impact statements, which contain reviews of the scientific literature and of the testing done by the manufacturers of the pesticide. There are a variety of other references that should be useful to you, which are listed in the material accompanying this program. Now let's take a moment to review some key points about toxicology. Toxicity is a characteristic of each chemical, and it consists of the whole pattern of adverse effects on a biological system. The patterns of response are highly consistent for any given level of exposure within a species, as we saw demonstrated in the dose-response relationship. Every toxic response is governed by the basic natural laws of physics, chemistry, and biology. And these responses are the result of physical and chemical reactions between the pesticide and certain chemicals that carry out the functions of the body. Every interaction of a chemical with a biological system follows an orderly dose-response relationship. For effects other than cancer and mutation, there exists an identifiable, no observable effect level that permits you to judge the impact of potential exposure to pesticides with some confidence. For cancer and genetic disease, a modified dose-response relationship is used to reflect our uncertainty of the existence of a no observable effect level. We must assume that the risk of cancer decreases with decreasing dose until it becomes essentially equivalent to zero. Lastly, analyses of the risk of pesticide exposure causing birth defects, miscarriage, mutations, and cancer must include a discussion of the high normal incidence of these genetic diseases in our population, the difficulty of detecting very small increases in this incidence, and the extremely small exposures found in the field versus those used in pesticide testing laboratories. Decisions about pesticide use are among the most important made in forest management today, and they aren't always easy. But a basic familiarity with the concepts of toxicology, together with the willingness to seek assistance from the many available resources, places you in a position to make confident, well-informed decisions about pesticide use in forestry.
Thank you.